If you're like most people, you've been using base 10 to count things since before you learned what numbers are. Decimal is by far the most common numbering system, but in many ways it's clearly not the best way to count things. The number 10 was chosen completely arbitrarily based on the number of fingers most people have, but when you think about it, there are other numbers that would work much nicer as a base. This is dozenal, a system that counts by 12s instead of by 10s. All you need is two extra digits for 10 and 11, and then you write 12 with 10. The standard among mathematicians for writing larger bases is to extend the Arabic numerals using the Latin alphabet, so 10 is written with the letter A, and 11 is written with the letter B. But actually, doing it that way makes 10 and 11 look like they're too separate from the rest of the digits, so you can use an inverted 2 for 10 and an inverted 3 for 11. But those don't display on most fonts, so you can approximate them with the letters T and E, which also happen to be the first letters of the English words 10 and 11. But actually, as long as we're okay with using the Latin alphabet to represent these digits, then we might as well use X for 10, like in Roman numerals. But actually, now we're back to having them look too different from the other 10 digits, so how about instead we use the Greek letters chi and epsilon, but actually, if we're using Greek letters, then there's no association between the X-looking letter and the number 10, so maybe you can write 10 with the Greek letter delta instead. And all you really need to learn is those two new digits, and you're ready to use dozenal. The first thing that's great about dozenal is that it's already common in some contexts, like if you're counting eggs, or pastries, or inches. Because of this, the vocabulary necessary already exists, and doesn't need to be created. You just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, dozen, dozen 1, dozen 2, and so on, until 2 dozen, 3 dozen, 4 dozen, and so on. A dozen does dozen is a gross, and a dozen gross is a great gross. Okay, so, you might run into a problem where when you say 10, people will assume you're talking about the number 12, because that's a problem that happens in real life, I think. So we can call it dec instead, and then we can call 11 L, which is a reference to Stranger Things. Also, I know that earlier I said that we can take advantage of already existing terminology, but let's call 12 dough instead of 12, or a dozen. And then a gross is a grow, and a great gross is mo? Yeah, that checks out. Now I know what you're thinking. If we're not taking advantage of existing terminology, what's the point of using dozenal at all? Well, there's two things that make bases fundamentally distinct from each other. The first is that the more digits a base has, the fewer digits it requires to represent larger numbers. So for example, if you look at every number up to a gross, a bit under a third of them require fewer digits to represent in dozenal than they do in decimal. In fact, the larger the numbers get, the more likely it is that the dozenal representation will be shorter, and the probability eventually reaches 100%. So for example, if you look at every number up to a million, it goes up to 16. Did I say goes up? I mean goes down. Okay, that doesn't matter. What does matter is the second thing that makes bases distinct from each other, which is that the number 12 has way more factors than the number 10. 10 only has two prime factors, 2 and 5, whereas 12 has 6 factors, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and 12. This makes dozenal far more convenient for division. In any base, you can tell what factors any given integer has in common with the base itself just by looking at the final digit. So in decimal, the last digit of any integer is enough information to tell if it's divisible by 2 and if it's divisible by 5, which, as we've established, are the two prime factors of 10. In dozenal, however, the last digit is enough information to tell if an integer is divisible by any of the 6 factors of 12. Check it out. If an integer ends with 0, it's divisible by 12. If it ends with 0 or 6, it's divisible by 6. If it ends with 0, 4, or 8, it's divisible by 4. If it ends with 0, 3, 6, or 9, it's divisible by 3. If it ends with 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, or 10, it's divisible by 2. And if it ends, it's divisible by 1. Divisibility tests are great, but what's even easier to see is how the different bases write simple rational numbers. 1/2 is 0.5 in decimal, because a half is 5/10. 3 doesn't go into 10, so it takes infinitely many digits to represent a third. 4 also doesn't go into 10, so a fourth is 0.25. All of these are very impractical and make decimal unnecessarily hard to use for writing simple ratios. In dozenal, all of this is better. A half is 0.6, 6/12. A third is 0.4, 4/12. And a fourth is 0.3, 3/12. As anyone can clearly see, this is objectively simpler than how decimal writes these ratios, and at this point I'm going to break character and ask the question you should be asking right now. Why did I stop at fourths? In decimal, a fifth is one of the simplest fractions to deal with, 0.2, because it's 2/10. However, not only does the number 5 not evenly go into the number 12, it's not even close to going into 12. A fifth is written as 0.2497 recurring. That's mathematically speaking the worst a base can possibly be at writing fifths. If you're the sort of person who wants to be able to quickly divide numbers by 5, dozenal suddenly stops looking as good. Dozenal? Pfft, more like dozental. But of course, the number 5 isn't that important, is it? And besides, if you want a base that can easily deal with halves, thirds, fourths, and fifths, you're gonna have to use base 60. And regardless, even if dozenal is bad with fifths, decimal is bad with thirds, and there's no objective reason to treat thirds as being less important than fifths. Allow me to introduce you to my actual favorite base. I'm Jan Miseli, and seximal is a better way to count. 6 is a very nice number. In fact, it's what mathematicians call a perfect number, which has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. As I said before when I was doing jokes, the things that make a base distinct are its size and its factors. We'll go over both of these separately, but before we really get into the why, I'm just gonna very quickly go through the how. Okay, numbers up to 12 have the same names as they do in decimal. From there, you count dozen 1, dozen 2, dozen 3, dozen 4, dozen 5, 30. Multiples of 6 work like multiples of 10, but they end with C instead of T. 6, 12, 30, 40, 50. 6 times 6 is nif, and nif times nif is Unexian. And that's all you need to know to understand this video. Part 1. 6 is a small number. The more digits a base has, the fewer digits it requires to represent larger numbers. The larger a number is, the more the size of the base matters. For any two bases, there is inevitably some number n, where absolutely all numbers larger than n require more digits to represent in the smaller base than they do in the larger base. You can think of this as being the point where the larger base outpaces, or indeed outbases, the other. Now, when you're comparing two bases that are similarly sized, like decimal and dozenal, this point is at an extremely large number, 12 to the 13th power in this case. This means that most numbers you deal with will be about the same length in both bases. However, 6 is considerably smaller than 10. The point where decimal outpaces seximal is at 10,000. A big number, sure, but nowhere near as big as 12 to the 13th. Based on this information, you might come to the conclusion that larger bases are inherently better at dealing with large numbers, and I wouldn't blame you for thinking that. It makes a lot of sense. However, it breaks down when you think about it in the extreme case. Pretend you're Plato and you really like the number 5040, or 3 Unexian 52 Nif, if you prefer. The point is, you think that it's a great number, and you want to start using it as a base. Since it's a really big base, it's very efficient for writing arbitrarily large numbers. Your Platonic base is able to write 1 million with just two digits. Now, in order to actually use such a base, you need to have 2 dozen 11 gross distinct digits. That's a lot of digits. Clearly, it would be extremely difficult to actually learn how to use it. It's intuitive that one digit in your system contains more information than one digit in decimal. But you don't know that because Arabic numerals haven't been invented yet. Actually, there's a lot of stuff you're not going to know about, so you should stop pretending to be Plato. What we need is a way to find a balance between large numbers being too long and individual digits being too numerous. This balance is what's called Radix economy, and you can measure how much a number costs in a given base by multiplying the number of digits by the log of the base itself, which is the amount of entropy, or the cost, per digit. Long story short, even though the Platonic base can write a million with two digits, those digits actually measurably cost more than the 7 digits it takes to write a million in decimal. By this metric, instead of larger bases gradually outbasing smaller bases for larger and larger integers, it's actually the smaller bases that do better and better for larger integers. This all boils down to smaller bases being more efficient than larger bases in the long run. It's somewhat counterintuitive, I know, but the math all checks out. There's one other big advantage of 6 being such a small number, which is that it makes doing simple arithmetic really, really easy. Like, ridiculously easy. The largest digit in seximal is 5, right? So that basically means that you can do any one-digit addition or subtraction problem by counting on your fingers. More on that in a bit. Multiplication is a bit trickier, but only having 6 digits helps out even more here. So there's 6 digits, which means there's nif products of 2 one-digit numbers. About half of those are repeats, which leaves us with 33 products. Anything multiplied by 0 is 0, and anything multiplied by 1 is itself. So those are all pretty trivial. That leaves us with just 10 one-digit products that need to be memorized in order to multiply in seximal. 2 times 2 is 4, 2 times 3 is 6, 2 times 4 is 8, 3 times 3 is 9, 2 times 5 is 10, 3 times 4 is 12, 3 times 5 is dozen 3, 4 times 4 is dozen 4, 4 times 5 is 32, and 5 times 5 is 41. Thanks to the nomenclature we're using, only 4 of those sound unfamiliar. So yeah, addition, subtraction, and multiplication are all much, much easier in seximal. Division is easier too, but before we get to that, part 2. Most people have 10 fingers. When all is said and done, what people are really looking for in a numbering system is a way to count things. Finger counting is one of the only things decimal has going for it. It makes some amount of sense. Most people have 10 fingers, so the number of fingers you have extended can directly correspond to some number from 0 to 10. You can count like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then you're out of fingers. Isn't this a bit wasteful though? For all of these, either one hand has no fingers extended, or one hand has all 5 fingers extended. What if we took advantage of the fact that we have 2 hands and instead counted like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, dozen 1, dozen 2, dozen 3, dozen 4, dozen 5, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55. There's a very nice correlation between the concept of after you get to 5, you need to use your other hand, and after you get to 5, you need to add another digit. Now, if you're familiar with the dozenal system, you've probably seen a certain way to count things on your hands in dozenal, where you count on the 12 segments of your fingers instead of on your 5 fingers. Yes, this can get you all the way to 12 on one hand, but actually think about it for a second. Think about the context where you're most likely to use finger counting, which is when you need to visually show someone numerical information. In the normal finger counting method, the number 4 looks like this, and the number 5 looks like this. They're nice and distinct, as are any two pairs of manual digits. In the dozenal counting method, the number 4 looks like this, and the number 5 looks like this. Can you honestly say that you would be able to consistently tell these two hand shapes apart from a distance? I know I wouldn't be able to. It's also worth mentioning that if you want, you can treat each finger as a separate binary digit, which gets you up to over 1,000 on both hands. This, of course, runs into problems if you're someone like me, and you can't move your pinky independently of your ring finger. Okay, so what was that thing I was saying about division earlier? Part 3. 6 is an antiprime. The number 12 has more factors than any number less than 12. This makes it a highly composite number. The thing is, there's another even cooler subset of highly composite numbers that have even more factors. These are the superior highly composite numbers, and not only do they have more factors than all the numbers smaller than themselves, they also have more factors than all the numbers larger than themselves, if you adjust for magnitude somewhat. SHCNs are an elite group, and they don't let just anyone in. They're in many ways the opposite of prime numbers. Since they have so many dang factors, antiprime bases are really good. Among them are numbers like 60, used for timekeeping, and 360, used for angle measure, and 5040, Plato's favorite. And yes, both 6 and 12. Let's step back for a moment and talk about divisibility tests. I don't know about you, but when I was in school, I had to use divisibility tests for decimal all the time. Looking at the last digit of a number only tells you what factors it has in common with 10. But that's not the only divisibility test that exists. You can generalize divisibility tests in any given base into two infinite families. The first type is the simpler one. If the last x digits of n in base b share a factor with b to the x, then n also shares that factor with b to the x. So, in decimal, if the last digit is even, the whole number is even, because 2 is a factor of 10, and if the last two digits are 00, 25, 50, or 75, the whole number is divisible by 25, because 25 is a factor of 10 squared. The second type of divisibility test is a bit more complicated. If you take the digits of n in base b and group them into substrings of length x, and add all those substrings together, the number n shares a factor with b to the x minus 1 if and only if that sum shares the same factor. So, in decimal, if you add the digits of a number together, the result can tell you what factors the original number has in common with 10 minus 1, which is 9. If you do the same thing, but instead of adding the digits, you add pairs of digits, you can see what factors the original number has in common with 1 less than 10 squared, which is 99. 99 is divisible by 9, and we already have a divisibility test for that, so dividing that out, we're left with 11. And would you look at that, 11 is exactly 1 more than 10. This will happen in any base, because for any number n, n squared minus 1 equals n plus 1 times n minus 1. Neat! Recap, in any given base, there's easy divisibility tests for factors of the base, and doable divisibility tests for factors of the numbers adjacent to the base. This doesn't just apply to divisibility tests, it's also reflected in the representations of rational numbers. In decimal, a half is written as 0.5, because it's equal to 5 tenths. In dozenal, a half is written as 0.6, because it's equal to 6 twelfths. In sexsimal, a half is written as 0.3, because it's equal to 3 sixths. 3 doesn't evenly go into 10, but it does evenly go into 9. In decimal, a third is written as 0.3 recurring, because it's equal to 3 ninths. In dozenal, a third is written as 0.4, because is equal to 4 twelfths. In sexsimal, a third is written as 0.2, because it's equal to 2 sixths. 4 doesn't evenly go into 10, but that's fine, because a fourth is just half of a half. In decimal, 1 half is 0.5, and half of 5 is 2.5, 2.5. So 1 fourth is 0.25. In dozenal, a fourth is written as 0.3, because it's equal to 3 twelfths. 4 doesn't evenly go into 6, but that's fine, because a fourth is just half of a half. In sexsimal, 1 half is 0.3, and half of 3 is 1.5, 1.3. So 1 fourth is 0.13. At this point, there's a very clear ranking for which bases are better at rational numbers than which other bases. Dozenal is the simplest, writing all three of these fractions with just one digit, followed by sexsimal, which needs two digits to write fourths, and in last place is decimal, which writes thirds with a recurring digit. This ranking becomes less obvious if we take fifths into account. In decimal, a fifth is written as 0.2, because it's equal to 2 tenths. 5 doesn't evenly go into 12, and it doesn't evenly go into 11. It also doesn't evenly go into 11 dozen 11, or 11 gross 11 dozen 11. It does, however, evenly go into 11 great gross 11 gross 11 dozen 11. In dozenal, a fifth is 0.2497 recurring, because it's equal to 2 great gross 4 gross 9 dozen 7 11 great gross 11 gross 11 dozen 11ths. 5 doesn't evenly go into 6 either, but that's because it's exactly 1 less than 6. In seximal, 1/5 is written as 0.1 recurring, by definition. Suddenly, the question of which of these bases is best at writing fractions is far more subjective. It's now a question of whether fourths are more important than fifths. For me, personally, I think that fifths are more important than fourths, and that it's much easier to derive fourths in seximal than it is to derive fifths in dozenal. I completely get where you're coming from if you disagree with that, but just so we're on the same page here, you're wrong. Now, why stop at fifths? There's still more to see. 6 doesn't evenly go into 10, but that's fine because a sixth is just half of a third. In decimal, a third is written as 0.3 recurring, and half of 3 is 1.5, 1.5. Adding all those infinite 5s to all but one of those infinite 1s, you get 0.1, then 6 recurring. In dozenal, a sixth is written as 0.2 because it's equal to 2 twelfths. In seximal, a sixth is written as 0.1, by definition. We're not going to stop there either, because of course seximal is good at writing sixths. No surprises there. This part, however, genuinely surprised me when I first found out about it. 7 doesn't evenly go into 10, 9, 99, 999, 9999, or 99,999. It does, however, evenly go into 999,999. In decimal, a seventh is written as 0.142857 recurring, because it's equal to 142,857,999,999. 7 doesn't evenly go into 12, 11, 11 dozen 11, 11 gross 11 dozen 11, 11 great gross 11 dozen 11, or 11 dozen 11 great gross 11 dozen 11. It does, however, evenly go into 11 gross 11 dozen 11 great gross 11 dozen 11. In dozenal, a seventh is written as 0.186135 recurring, because it's equal to 1 gross 8 dozen 10 great gross 10 gross 3 dozen 5 11 gross 11 dozen 11 great gross 11 dozen 11ths. Phew! Both of those were very complicated, but we're all okay with that, because nobody ever needs to use sevenths, right? 7 doesn't evenly go into 6 either, and it certainly doesn't evenly go into 5. The thing is, 7 is 1 more than 6, which means that it necessarily evenly goes into 55. In seximal, 1/7 is written as 0.05 recurring, because it's equal to 5/55. Hopefully, you can see where I'm coming from by now. Sure, dozenal is slightly better at fourths, but at what cost? The simplest ratio that seximal really does a bad job at representing is 1/11, which it writes as 0.03134524221 recurring. Everything simpler than 11ths needs, at most, 3 digits. Personally, I think we can all agree that you don't ever need to use 11ths. Part 4, conclusion. By now, I'm sure you can see why I say that seximal is better than decimal and dozenal. I didn't even get into the stuff like the history of yam counting in New Guinea, or how to use base nif to make seximal numbers half the length, or even how to say numbers larger than Unexian. If you haven't been convinced, feel free to argue about it in the comment section. If anyone brings up some, like, actually good counterpoints, I might make a follow-up video about them. Anyway, until then, for more information, go over to seximal.net, which is a pretty much comprehensive resource on the seximal system. I've been Jan Miseli, and I don't have a sign-off for my videos that aren't about conlanging.